Hello and welcome to Community Christian Church Online Campus. You guys, we're so glad that you are here today. And real quick, before we get started, we are going to celebrate communion together at the end of the service. So if you want to run to the kitchen real quick and grab some juice and crackers or bread and wine or whatever it is that you want, you'll be ready for that. And I hope that you are ready for worship, because right now we're going to join the band and let's worship together.
Charlie, it's good to be with you from wherever you're watching. We just hope you feel the presence of God where you are. If this is the first time you've caught this, just appreciate that you're here. Let's worship God through song.
Thank you.
spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living Lord. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? There's a lot of times when I talk, I'll say things like, hey, you can bring the kingdom down because you can meet a need because you're able to. And I don't want to give the wrong impression. I don't want any of you out there to think that I'm telling you that works will get the job done, that you have to do something to earn your way into heaven, or that God can be pleased with you only if you serve someone. And I heard a lyric in a song this week, and it said, there's no first in lines at the foot of the cross. And that just for the next 20 minutes of my drive, that lyric just kept spinning around in my head because we attach so much human nature to firsts. Firsts are important, but there's no first at the foot of the cross. There's no I got saved first. It's just I got saved. There's no I met Jesus first. It's just I met Jesus. There's no I got forgiveness of my sins first, so there. It's just I got forgiveness for my sins. So sometimes when I talk about bringing the kingdom down, God's kingdom to earth, even just for a moment, I want you to think about that in terms of how you live. Not necessarily just serving somebody else, but do you show the kingdom of God in your actions, in your words, in your posts on social media, in the way you talk to your children, in the way you treat your wife in front of your children, in the way you interact with a complete stranger or a server at a restaurant? I remember on a job interview one time, the senior pastor took me out to dinner after like four or five interviews that I'd already had. And I got home, and my wife said, "How'd it go?" And I said, "I wouldn't have hired me. It was horrible. I fumbled over my words. I couldn't complete a thought. I was just so nervous." And I got the job, and it was probably years later. I said, "Hey, why'd you hire me? Because I hosed up that restaurant interview so bad." And he said, "Oh, you were already hired, man." He said, "I took you there because if you didn't make eye contact with your server, I was going to turn you away." He wanted to know if I could engage in somebody that was there to serve me as an equal. That is bringing the kingdom of heaven in. That is putting your love for God on display. He will continue to do the things that he promised he would do, but he lets us play.
Faithfulness, faithfulness. never failed me
campus. Happy shiny new year to you. What a great way to start the year by worshiping together. We're just really glad you're here. My name is Shelley Mosteller. I'm the creative arts pastor, and we would love to know that you are out there. So, give us a shout out in the comments if you're watching while this is streaming. Also, you can grab your phone or another device, go to communitychristianchurch.com, click connect. You can fill out this digital connect card. Tell us whatever you want to tell us. If there's something that we can be praying about for you and your family, we would love to do that. If you have any questions, comments, anything like that. You also click church online. You can go to kids com worship, small group opportunities, anything that you need to know. It's pretty much on that website. And then another way I would love for you guys to start the new year is joining me in reading the Bible all the way through in 2021. This is something that my dad started me on 29 years ago, and I have never regretted it. So what I do every year, I have a YouVersion group where you use the YouVersion app. We do a group plan together, and we read it through the whole year long. And we have a private Facebook group that we can comment on and stuff like that. So if that is something that you would like to do, you guys, you can read the whole Bible in 15 minutes a day. And if you don't like to read, guess what? You can listen to it. So many of the translations have audio versions, so you can pop your earbuds in 15 minutes every single day. You'll go all the way through the Bible, and let me tell you, it makes a huge difference. The more entrenched we are in His Word, the more He can use it to change us. So if you are interested in joining that group, it is not too late. You've only missed a couple of days. That's no big deal. You could make that up. Shoot me an email, shelley@communitychristianchurch.com, and we'll get you plugged in. And you guys, offering is absolutely anytime you want it. We love the fact that you partner along with us to continue making a difference. We have so many opportunities to reach out into our community and into our world that we've never had before. So thank you for partnering with us. You can text give, you can give electronically, you can give on the website, you can snail mail it in an offering envelope. You guys, it's so easy. And we just appreciate everything that you're doing. So right now, grab your YouVersion app, pop that open, or grab a paper Bible, sit down, get all ready. We're going to join Noah in the very last of our micro series. See ya, 2020.
Well, guys, I have to start off by simply saying that I am sorry. All right, I'm sorry for even mentioning the year 2020 this morning. I'm sure that at this point, most of us have framed that as ancient history, and so I have to repent for even bringing it up. My name is Noah Hinson. I'm the student pastor here at Community. Thank you so much for joining us this morning in person or online. And I know that I shouldn't even mention it, but I only mention it to say that we have finally completed whatever you want to call the last 365 days, or 367 if you want to count this past weekend, right? Like, we got to midnight on Thursday, and we all screamed out Jumanji, and we're just waiting for it to go back to normal now, right? And some of you are probably thinking that I'm too old for that reference, and you're probably right. I'm cutting it close, but I swear the person that comes to mind is Robin Williams and not The Rock, all right? We have finally made it, though. We finally made it to 2020, and even though we've been dreaming about this day, it seems as though the world is still full of chaos and struggle and sickness and trouble. A new year has begun, and yet not all that much has suddenly changed. And we do this kind of thing every year, right? Like, this isn't unique to just 2021. Every year, we approach a new year and we start to think about all these aspects of our lives that we hope to get better as we turn the calendar page, right? Like, we plan to work out more and start a diet, and we plan to start a new habit that's gonna change our life for the better. And we plan out how when the next year begins, everything is gonna look different for us. And some of us actually start to follow through too, like until March or April or May even, if you're really good. And then at that point, we're close enough to next January that we might as well just give it up and then start again then. Right? We project our hopes on the future and we convince ourselves that this thing will change when. Or when we're in the midst of difficult and frustrating circumstance and we think to ourselves, well, it will all get better when. If you're taking notes this morning, that's the title of my message. It will all get better when. A 17th century French philosopher named Blaise Pascal wrote this. He said, "We are so unwise that we wander about in times that don't belong to us, and we don't think of the only one that does. We're so vain that we dream about the times that are not and blindly flee the only one that is, and thus we never actually live, but hope to live." And I think that this is a little more critical of a statement than I would make, but then again, I'm a horrible procrastinator, and so the whole idea of putting things off until the next minute feels pretty good to me. But I guess he has a point, right? Like, if we are not careful, if we're not careful, we run the risk of being so enveloped in what we hope for in the future that we fail to accomplish or experience anything fully in the moment. And don't hear me wrong, I'm not condemning an optimistic perspective or the power of anticipation. I think that there is value in looking forward to something, so long, though, as we don't miss what we've been called to in the moment that we're in. Or even more importantly, so long as we don't miss that God is active, present, and moving in whatever present reality we're living. And some of us have had a hard year. I don't want to discount that or ignore that. Some of us have experienced loss of income and conflict in our home life. We've experienced depression, anxiety, conflict in our marriage, with our kids. We've lost people that we love. And if that is you living in that reality, then you need to hear that things will get better. There are better days ahead. I have read the end of the book, and we are promised that a day is coming when we're not going to have to deal with all of these most difficult parts of being human anymore. But more importantly, you need to hear this truth that God is present in this moment. And in the worst moments of your past year, by the power of his Spirit, God was with you through those times. David is one of these characters who is no stranger to hardship in this life. He has this perspective of struggle that he writes about in the Psalms. And in Psalm 42, he writes this. He says, God is our refuge and our strength, an ever-present help in trouble, and therefore we will not fear. Though the earth gives way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. Who had tsunamis and earthquakes on their 2020 bingo card? Anybody? I mean, this year has been tough, right? Like, it's been discouraging for so many reasons. And I think that so many of us, when we encounter any kind of hardship or trouble like we've experienced in this past year, we try to look past that hardship and look forward to a different time. And I think that that is a good and healthy thing, but I think the flip side of that, if we're not careful, is that we can take on this attitude of it'll all get better when. This year has been tough and stressful, and I've encountered problems in my marriage and friction with my spouse, but we don't have to go any deeper than that because it's just a season. And it'll all get better when I return to work or life gets back to normal. Or I've encountered struggles in my parenting and I'm seeing unsettling tendencies in the life of my child, but it'll all get better when they go back to school or they start a new sport, or this is just a phase in their life and it'll be better when it's over. And my relationship with God, it's really shaky right now, and I haven't been in church very much lately, and my time in the Word is scarce, and my prayer life is tanking, but it's just a season, right? And it's been a crazy year. Life has been stressful. I'll get closer. I'll get right with God. When? And I don't know if you can relate to this kind of mindset at all, but I have a strong hunch that this is human tendency. And we see patterns like this in the lives of people in Scripture too. And the first person that comes to mind is this dude named Elijah in the Bible, right? And Elijah can relate to us and we can relate to him because this dude had one hard year. Elijah was a prophet of God that we can read about in 1 Kings. And that's the beginning of how we know this dude's life was rough. I mean, being prophet was not a great gig. Sure, he got to listen and he got to hear like the actual voice of God and experience his presence. But the problem was that when God commanded him to do something, he actually had to do it. And that was the kicker, right? And so Elijah got to witness these incredible things that God was doing firsthand, but he also got a lot of flack when those incredible things ticked somebody off. And we're gonna pick up Elijah's story in 1 Kings chapter 19, if you wanna flip over there. But let's set up some background for a second first. All right, Elijah had just been through a really rough year, a rough couple of years, actually. All right, the king of Israel, which was God's chosen nation, his chosen people, the king of Israel during this time was an evil king, and he ignored the word of God, and he worshiped these other gods, and God picked Elijah to be the one to go tell this guy off. And this evil king named Ahab, he wouldn't listen. And so God sent a drought on the whole land of Israel for 3 years. And that drought led to famine, and that famine just ticked off Ahab even more. And so Ahab promises that he's going to start to hunt down and kill Elijah. And after 3 years of drought and famine, and Elijah somehow surviving, God tells Elijah to go back and confront Ahab again. And when he does, he has to go through this whole showdown with a bunch of these pagan prophets. It's like him versus an army, and it's a scary time, and he gets out of it okay, and then God finally lets it rain. But when God does let it rain, finally, he does it by sending this like massive monsoon that just ticks off evil Ahab even more. And what makes matters worse is that evil Ahab had an evil wife that was even worse than he was, and they promised to hunt him down and kill him. All right, and that is a really brief summary, all right? That's like the spark notes of the spark notes. So if you are looking for something to dive into as you start the new year, check out that story in the Old Testament. All right, it's not as intimidating as it seems. Elijah's a really good spot to start. But even though Elijah has been the firsthand witness to all these incredible things that God has done, and he knows that God can protect him, he is absolutely terrified. And he retreats to this place in his mind that says, it'll all get better when. It'll all get better when. And this is where we're going to start in 1 Kings chapter 19. Check out verse 3. Elijah has been through a rough year, right? Ahab and his evil wife Jezebel are threatening him. And it says in verse 3, Elijah was afraid. And he ran for his life. And when he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servant there while he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness. And he came to a broom bush and sat down under it and prayed that he might die. I've had enough, Lord. Take my life. I'm no better than my ancestors. And then he laid down under the bush and he fell asleep. Have any of you prayed a prayer like that in this past year? Or in a really difficult season of your life? Like, God, I'm just done. I've had enough. I'm done. Elijah is at the complete end of himself in this moment. He's exhausted and he's afraid. And in this moment, he is real and raw with God. And watch what God does next. This is really important. It says, all at once, an angel touched him. All at once, not after Elijah like prayed hard enough, not after he screamed loud enough, not after he jumped through enough religious hoops. In a moment, God was there with him, right? And God says, get up and eat. And he looked around, and there by his head was some bread baked over hot coals and a jar of water, and he ate and drank, and then he laid down again. And an angel of the Lord came back a second time and touched him and said, get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you. So he got up, and he ate and drank, and strengthened by that food, he traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. And there he went into a cave and spent the night. Now, this is super important right here. Elijah traveled for over a month to this mountain way far away from Israel, where he had been told he had work that he needed to do. He was scared and overwhelmed, and he ran all the way to Horeb. Which, if you want a really fun Googleable fact, Horeb is about 334 miles from where Elijah started at Mount Carmel. And this wasn't just a random mountain in the middle of nowhere. This is the same mountain where God gave Elijah's ancestor Moses the Ten Commandments. This was a mountain, this was a place known for God showing up in incredible, miraculous, and powerful ways. Don't miss this. Elijah was overwhelmed, afraid, and exhausted, and he thought to himself, it'll all get better when. When I make it to this mountain and where God can show up to me. Right? Never mind that if you flip back just a few pages in your Bible, you can see Elijah facing an army and calling on the name of the Lord and God sending fire from heaven to save him. Right? But Elijah was overwhelmed, and things were looking rough, and he thought to himself, it'll all get better when. When I travel hundreds of miles to find God in a cave. It'll all get better when. And Elijah gets this cave, and he's ready to experience this incredible thing, and God shows up to him and says, what are you doing here? What are you doing here, Elijah? And Elijah just kind of loses it, and he says, I've been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites, they've rejected your covenant. They've torn down your altars. They put your prophets to death with a sword, and I'm the only one left, and they're going to kill me too. But did you notice that Elijah never really answers the question here? Are any of you parents with little kids? Have you ever asked a little kid a question, and they start to tell you a whole story? And then after they get done, you realize that the question you asked never really got answered in the first place. Their brain found some kind of connection between the question you asked and the story they wanted to tell, but it never really got to a point where it answered the question he asked. And Elijah totally does this. God asks him what he's doing, and then he tells God this whole story. Right? And it's a sad story, right? Like Elijah's going through a rough time, but he gets done, and God is like, okay, but that still doesn't explain what you're doing here. But God does understand what's happening with Elijah, even if it doesn't follow a logical line, right? Like any good parent, he understands what Elijah is longing for, even if he is completely mistaken in the way he's going about trying to find it. And so God says, go out to the mouth of the cave, for the presence of God is going to pass by. And Elijah is probably thinking in this moment, finally, this is exactly what I've been waiting for. This is going to solve all my problems. This is it. And God starts to show up to Elijah. It says, then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord wasn't in the fire. But after the fire came a gentle whisper. And God asked this question again. What are you doing here, Elijah? And Elijah still doesn't completely get it. He starts to melt down all over again, and he says, I've done everything you asked, and my world is still crumbling, and I'm completely alone. And so finally, God has to spell it out for him. And I don't know why, but every time I read these last few verses here, I can feel like that climactic music building in the background. Because this is a culmination of a long and painful process for Elijah. And in this moment, God kind of pulls back the curtain and reveals just a small glimpse of his own perspective on Elijah's life. And man, how great would it be sometimes if we could see our lives through God's eyes, even for just a moment in the midst of when we're most overwhelmed. And so God answers Elijah and he says, go back the way you came. Go to the desert of Damascus, and when you get there, anoint Hazael, king over Aram, and also anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, king over Israel, and anoint Elijah, son of Shaphat, from Abel, Manoah, to succeed you as prophet. And Jehu will put to death any who escape the sword of Hazael, and Elisha will put to death any who escape the sword of Jehu. And yet I reserve 7,000 in Israel, all whose knees have not bowed down to Baal and whose mouths have not kissed him. Elijah makes this long, tedious journey looking for God, thinking it's all gonna get better when. And when he finally gets there and God finally shows up and it's not in the way he wanted or expected it to, God says, go back. And I'm not dogging on Elijah here. I'm not making fun of him. I'm talking about it this way because when I read this story and I see Elijah, I see my own life. I see myself. I see a struggle that shows up in my own heart too, and I hope that you can relate to it. I mean, how often do we encounter struggle and trouble and get overwhelmed in our life and think it'll all get better when? But we miss the fact that in an instant, the God of the universe can be right by our side when we call. And I can see this pattern in my life, right? The same pattern. When I was in high school and I struggled in my faith, I used to think, well, it'll all get better when. When I make it to Bible college, that's when God's gonna really take hold of me and change things. And when I got to Bible college and I struggled in my faith, I used to think, well, it'll all get better when. Right, when I find a church home and I start working in a church somewhere. And as I go through my life, I find myself doing it again and again, it'll all get better when. And God might very well show up if you go over to the other side of the globe looking for him, but he is also present here and now in this moment. And we don't have to wait to discover God's plan for our lives. We don't have to put off obedience in him because we're overwhelmed or scared or we just want to procrastinate. God is right here, active, moving, and present in this moment. Just waiting for you to be obedient and trust in him. And as we fail and miss the point and go looking for a mountaintop experience, when he had something for us right where we were, he'll show us grace and he'll lead us back. But we miss out on what he has planned right in front of us when we get stuck in this it'll all get better mentality. And I feel like I've said these words more this year than ever before, both to my own heart and to other people too. But hear me, because this is incredibly important. There is a God in heaven who knows you by name and has an incredible plan and purpose for your life. And he is waiting for you to discover that plan like a giddy parent on Christmas morning. We don't have to put it off. We don't have to wait. God has incredible things in store for us right here in this moment. And as we encounter difficulty and hardship and struggle and trouble, he will be present in those moments too. And more than that, we have a Savior in Christ Jesus that can relate to us in our struggle because he encountered the same struggles we did. But the difference is he didn't fail, and so he paves the way and sets a perfect example for us in our struggle. Check this out in chapter 12 of Hebrews. This is a letter written to followers of Jesus just like you and me. It says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. And consider him who endured such opposition from sinners so that you might not grow weary or lose heart." We have been intentionally created and specifically called by a God who loves us as his own children and who has an incredible plan and purpose for our lives. And as we follow that plan, as we run that race marked out for us and answer that calling, as we encounter hardship along the way and feel overwhelmed, be reminded that God is present and active and moving in those most difficult moments. I want to challenge you. I want to beg you as we begin a new year to begin it with an attitude, with a disposition in your heart, not that says things will get better when, but rather that looks to see what God is calling you to do right now, right here in this moment, being reminded by the power of his Spirit that he is right with you even in the worst moments. Elijah traveled hundreds of miles to find God and found out that what God had for him was right where he already was. And how often do we go looking for a greener grass and try to forget the past and keep moving on and think it'll all get better when, and we miss what God had in store right in front of us? Don't wait. Don't wait to be a better husband. Don't wait to be a better wife. Don't wait to be a better parent or friend. Don't wait to invest and grow in your relationship with a God that loves you. If you need someone to talk to pray over you, you can reach out to us in the comments or online on our website. We would love to get connected with you and talk with you. But as we begin a new year, how can you discover what God is waiting to do in your life right now? What is he calling you to right here and now? Let me pray. God, I just thank you so much for who you are. God, I thank you that you love us and that you have a plan for our lives that would just blow our mind. God, and then you're not a distant, estranged parent, that you are experiencing life with us as we go through the highs and the lows. God, I pray that as we step into a new year, that you would remind us that each step of the way you have intentionally called us. God, that you have incredible things in store for us, and you're just waiting for us to discover them. God, I pray peace over each and every person that's hearing these words, that as they begin something new, that they'll just be comforted by you. That they'll not put off the moment and just wait for something where it'll all get better when, but God, that they will experience what you have in store for them right here and now. God, I pray all these things in your name. In the name of Jesus, I pray, amen.
We're going into our time of communion and prayer now. So if we can pray for you, your family, heading into this new year, please let us know how we can pray for you. You can tell us in the comments, or you can message us, or you can call us this week. Just let us know what's going on. We would love to pray for you. We'd love to pray for you right now. And we are going to celebrate communion together, and we drink the juice, the wine, we eat the bread. We do these things to remind us of Jesus. He gave his life so that we could run this race with him. And so we really do want to throw off everything that hinders us, and we want to be in the moment with him, not taking anything for granted. So as the band leads us in one last song, and as you take communion, can you think about that this year? Can you bathe this year in prayer? And can you be in this moment with him?
Children, their children.
Thanks for joining us. So glad you were here. Go have an amazing week. Make somebody else's day brighter, and we will see you next time.